Good day. Thanks for attending this session in which I will give you my impressions after spending 10 years of my life working on Eclipse working groups. So I'm Gaël Blondel. I'm the VP ecosystem development of the Eclipse Foundation. As you can hear, I'm French and I have been involved in Eclipse working groups since the inception of the concept. I see my personal mission as helping more companies do more open source. Because I think that, well, you know, the more open source, the better the world. So to set the context for this presentation, let's have a look at what the Eclipse Foundation became over time. It's been created in 2004 to provide vendor-neutral governance and to support the open source ecosystem around the Eclipse development tools. Over the years, we grew to be a leading umbrella open source foundation that supports nearly 400 open source projects and a community of more than 1,500 committers, plus lots of contributors. Eclipse projects cover various domains like enterprise Java, IoT, automotive, development tools, or artificial intelligence. We have more than 300 corporate members who collaborate thanks to the Eclipse governance model and processes, especially in the context of working groups. Our tagline is the community for open innovation and collaboration. In terms of community, our Eclipse development process and the Eclipse governance foster transparency, openness, and meritocracy. Even if we are a member-driven organization, all Eclipse projects and communities are open to all individuals and organizations. I'll come back to that later. We are code first, meaning that we put marketing behind, as we observe that our successful projects are the ones that provide good and useful code. And finally, we are commercial friendly in the way that the intellectual property of Eclipse projects allows users to download Eclipse platform and use them as a foundation for their products. So we are in the weak copyleft and permissive part of the licensing spectrum. Let's talk about the inception of working groups at the Eclipse Foundation. So in 2010, the Eclipse Foundation and Airbus started to evaluate the possibility of hosting a sub-organization under the governance of the foundation. The goal was to avoid the cost and time required by Airbus and its partners to create a new open source foundation to support their toolchain dedicated to embedded critical systems like fly-by-wire commands. Creating a fully operational open source foundation requires months or even years and lots of money. So the idea is that an Eclipse working group is a sort of foundation in a box that relies on the existing governance and processes and extends them with dedicated efforts to various activities like roadmap management, open specification, brand management, shared marketing activities, and in some cases, co-development. Those discussions with Airbus and others led to the creation of Polarsys, the first functional Eclipse working group dedicated to open source tools for embedded systems. Polarsys was user-driven, meaning that users define the requirements and coordinate the roadmap. And some of those users, some founding members, were Ericsson and Airbus, for example. Some of the goals were very long-term support with a target of 40 to 60 years of support for tools used in energy or aerospace industry. And also another goal was to ease tools qualification and certification for usage in aeronautics, space, and automotive. But with not enough diversity of members and a lack of industry leadership, and also with the divergence of two competing projects, we ended up with terminating the working group in 2018. That said, we learned a lot from this experience, especially that collaboration is never easy. Well, surprise. So two main important results of Polarsis are that it helped us design a better approach to working groups. And also on the technology side, it contributed lots of improvements to Eclipse Papyrus and Eclipse Capella and other parts of Eclipse modeling projects that are still very important in the Eclipse ecosystem today. The same year as Polarsis, the Eclipse IoT working group was created. Interestingly, the full initiative was addressing topics not related to tools at all. That was not the first time the Eclipse Foundation had projects not related to Eclipse development tools, but that was certainly interesting to see a new community standing on the shoulders of the Eclipse governance to create a technical ecosystem for an IoT stack. The approach was code first, developer driven, with several actors who had been involved previously with the Eclipse development process and recognized the importance of rigorous and sometimes boring IP management, transparent development process, and a balanced governance between interests of corporations and developers. The success of this initiative with several projects like PAO or Mosquito that are heavily used for MQTT, for example, or with Cura as a framework for gateways, led to a strategic move from Bosch and to the fact that they increased their leadership globally in Eclipse and more specifically in Eclipse IoT working group in 2015. And I would like to give this quote from Stefan Ferber, our champion at Bosch, who is CEO of Bosch IO, that no company can realize the IoT on its own, and that Bosch joined Eclipse IoT because within the Eclipse community, through the contribution of many IoT developers, tools and standards are created on an open platform that many companies can benefit from for their IoT applications. So over the years, the Eclipse IoT working group attracted projects that cover all the functional concerns of IoT, from managing very small devices to collecting data in the cloud, including some IoT gateways and digital twin platforms. After 8 years of existence, the working group has now more diversity in membership with large organizations, smaller organizations, and also startups. And it also managed to clarify the complementarity between potentially competing projects. And finally, it established the Eclipse Foundation as a key player for IoT in open source. So in 2020, we have 8 million lines of code, 45 projects, more than 350 contributors, and 45 member organizations. And one of the most recent initiatives is the creation of Eclipse IoT packages to foster interoperability and synchronous release of subsets of projects in the working group. So Eclipse IoT demonstrates that our code-first approach works and that initiatives that mix developer champions with some corporate strategies build successful open source ecosystems. My third example is Jakarta IE, our biggest initiative in terms of working groups. So in 2017, that's what we have on this photo, Oracle, with partners like IBM, Red Hat, Tommy Tribe, and others, announced at Java One that Java IE would become truly open source at the Eclipse Foundation. We had to rename it to not use the term Java, and the community chose Jakarta IE as a new name for this initiative. And the initiative came with several challenges, moving a large code base, including the standard APIs and Glassfish as the reference implementation. So that's something like 50 projects, almost 140 Git repositories, more than 50 Jenkins build instances, and more than 60 million lines of code. Also creating an open alternative to the Java community process to manage the standards. And finally, working with a vibrant community that had grown over 20 years, as well as with large and smaller software companies. A high-level roadmap was quickly published, and that helped to stay connected with different stakeholders, and also to address the impatience of the most enthusiastic members of the community. Indeed, the creation of Jakarta E was expected by lots of people and organizations who were frustrated by the previous status quo. But even with a strong commitment from Oracle and the other leading organizations, it took longer than initially expected to move to a really open source ecosystem. One of the main activities was to develop the Eclipse Foundation specification process to replace the Java community process in Jakarta E. So we adapted our Eclipse development process. And Eclipse specifications are managed in a similar way as open source projects, but with a particular care of managing the intellectual property flows in a way that is compatible with the creation of open standards. And that's not necessarily easy, I can tell you. And we also add at some point to enable individuals to participate to the specification process based on their merits. So we took care that this process is well-established open source, open process to create open standards, that it complies with all the rules that makes it possible to use those open standards and also for companies to contribute to those open standards. But we also managed to involve individuals to participate in the process. An important thing to mention is that from the beginning, the leading organizations committed the necessary financial resources to allow the Eclipse Foundation to build a dedicated team. That was necessary to address one of the big topics of Jakarta E, the fact that technology compatibility kit become open source and that everybody can contribute to improve it. Very good news for the community, but not easy, as it also means that passing the TCK on Glassfish was transferred to the working group. And this requires significant release engineering effort, as well as significant hardware resources to run it. As you can see on this slide, the Jakarta team also invested lots of efforts in relationship with the community in terms of openness and transparency. And to engage with the community, the working group participated in numerous developer conferences and also started to create its own online events, Jakarta live stream events, Jakarta One live stream events. We had the first Jakarta One live stream in September 2019 with 1,400 attendees. And since then, we also launched regional events with language-specific events like Jakarta One live stream Japan, and more recently, Jakarta One live stream Brazil. Finally, we regularly create new community outreach programs. For example, we sponsor a Crowdcast account for virtual meetups organized by the Java user groups. And that's been very successful since last March. So, key successes from Jakarta E has been to establish and to be able to communicate clear goals and to also put together the different industry leaders to achieve a common objective, to establish credibility for the brand, and also to establish the open specification process with input from all the stakeholders. The lesson learned is that transferring important intellectual property can be complex, challenging, and that it takes time. Attracting new participant members requires also time and deliberate effort. Transparency is key, it's important, it has been a success in Jakarta, but it takes effort. And also using all the possible channels to engage the community is really important. Before jumping to my conclusions, I would like to tell the story of Eclipse Automotive Working Groups. So first, we created an Eclipse Automotive Working Group in 2010 with a focus on building a common Eclipse tooling platform for the automotive industry to integrate some domain-specific standards like AUTOSAR to hopefully avoid the redevelopment of common features. We could say to avoid reinventing the wheel, which is interesting in automotive. But we had, at the time, not enough traction and not enough focus, and also not enough investments from the members. So it failed due to the lack of a joint vision by the members. But then we still had lots of connections in automotive, and then we realized that smaller, more focused working group could work better. And according to Elinor Ostrom, who received the Nobel Prize of Economy for her work on the management of the commons, more focus helps collaborate with more clearly defined boundaries, enables more effective monitoring of progress, and shorter processes for collective choices. So over the years, we implemented this model on smaller working groups with OpenMDM for the management of data from car test and diagnosis, OpenPass, that's simulators for test of autonomous systems, OpenADX to integrate toolchains for the development of autonomous vehicles, and more working groups. And now, almost 10 years later, we are back at thinking about a more ambitious plan to maybe set up an umbrella automotive initiative. That's what I like in this history is that potentially 10 years ago, creating the Eclipse Automotive Working Group, we had not enough common goals to make it successful. And in between, by going through smaller initiatives, we have now a more global ecosystem for that potentially enables the creation of such an Eclipse Automotive initiative. So stay tuned. I just mentioned few Eclipse working groups, but you can see here that we have 15 active working groups, and I can tell you that we work on the creation of a handful of more working groups. So they all share some common characteristics. So they use a similar open source licensing model based on business-friendly intellectual property management. They use the same project development process to coordinate activities. They use the same governance model to ensure a level playing field for all participants. And they get this out of the box as part of building their working group inside the Eclipse Foundation. And on top of this common layer, they build marketing activities, developer advocacy, test capabilities, and more, depending on their needs and ambition. On our side, even if we see that each working group is different, we manage to put together a process that we customize for each working group, whether it is user-driven or technology-driven, whether it's a large initiative like Jakarta or a smaller initiative, and whether it's an established community that is looking for a safe place to collaborate or a new community in a new domain. And in terms of lesson learned, so we think that successful working groups require dedicated staff. You absolutely need a program manager to coordinate all the activities. You need some time from our IP, infrastructure, release engineering, and web team. And also, at some point, you need a marketing coordinator as soon as the group wants to participate to conferences, to organize events, to create promotion material like use cases, success stories, or other marketing collaterals to help grow the community. And if you want to attract developers, like if you produce APIs or standards, you need a developer advocate and potentially a developer advocacy program, like a champion program to recruit champions in the domain. Also, more lesson learned is that corporate collaboration is not easy. Surprise. That requires constant effort and championship. You have to invest in the relationship with the leaders, and you need leaders at the developer level, management level, and also at the top management level. You have to value, respect, and engage with the community. And also, open specifications can be a key feature. I'm really enthusiastic about seeing more and more open standards that will be supported by open source implementations and will increase interoperability and our capability to create new applications. One last thing is that it's really important for me and my colleagues as staff of a nonprofit open source foundation to always stick to our core principles of transparency, openness, and meritocracy. So by transparency, we mean that everything should be written on mailing list or another public media like wiki page or forum. Openness means that everybody can participate to an open source project. And meritocracy means that everybody has to demonstrate their skills and will to participate before they can be elected as a committer and a full member of the project. So that's whether when you implement collaborations in structures like Eclipse working groups, it's always important to keep that in mind for all our projects and all our working groups. That's the core principles that we apply. Thank you. And yeah, I'm now looking forward to our Q&A session. Thanks.
Thanks for listening. So we have two questions. So I don't know how much of the roadmap is defined with the volunteer community as opposed to being set by a small team of committers or project leaders. Yeah, that's an interesting point. I think that there are several sides about it. So what we observe, especially in Jakarta EE, for example, where you know Java EE has been there for 20 years, and there are plenty of freelance consultants who make all their business on Java EE and are now very committed to, very interested in Jakarta EE. So the point, what's interesting is that they are very vocal. So their point of view is taken into account in the roadmaps by the larger organizations. But I think that's always true, that the more developers a company can inject in a project, or the more then the more leadership they get. So yes, yeah, of course there is a part, the roadmap is mainly defined by the people who will work on the project, and in the several examples I gave, that's mostly people who work for a company. And that's part of their daily job. But still, I think that the projects are open and transparent, and even when there are some big corporations, we do everything to keep the project open and transparent. And so there is a place for community members to give their opinion and. And also there are, for example, in IoT and in Jakarta, we also organize developer survey. So I think that's also a good way to get the feedback of the users of the technology. Because basically what I described here is how to use open source to co-develop or to co-promote some open source platforms. And yes, the question, the topic about...
it's going to just get all the information finally for Pathable to start getting their agenda together.
Yes. Different goals on the roadmap. How do we manage to do that? Well, I guess that there's no magic. So that's one of the examples of Polarsys. At some point, we ended up in a situation where we were lacking industry leadership. So there was not a clear roadmap enough. And on the technology side, we started to have competing projects, and they didn't manage to find to take the high road, so they didn't invest enough in collaboration. And basically, we just provide the framework. We provide the framework, and we provide the experience about how to run it. But if there's not enough collaboration or not a common roadmap, then it doesn't work. But that can also be a question of maturity. I was mentioning the point with automotive, and in automotive, I think that 10 years ago, open source in automotive was new, and we were talking to people only interested in an open source tooling platform, so mostly the core initial projects of Eclipse. Now, 10 years later, we have more and more interest in those kind of companies. They know that they have to do autonomous driving and this kind of stuff. And that's typically places where open source platforms are also have a potential. Yeah, just maybe to conclude in a few words, this presentation, I've been attending lots of the presentations of the conference so far. I think that this presentation was certainly a bit more about the corporate side and using open source, but that's also what I like in what's being done at the Open Source Initiative. It's that it goes from presentations like the Extreme Copyleft yesterday to this more corporate friendly collaboration. And this diversity is very interesting in my opinion. Thanks. See you there.